Lauren. Now, politics has changed a lot in the last year or so. They used to say a Liberal vote is a wasted vote, if only. With me to discuss the plight of Britain's third political force is the Deputy Leader of the Liberal Democrats, Simon Hughes. Thank you for coming. Now, yesterday, Lord Oakeshott, who was your Treasury spokesman, the Lib Dem Treasury spokesman, said, if this is robust action on bank bonuses, my name's Bob Diamond, he said. I thought it was quite funny.
The audience
disagrees. And then today, 88 Liberal Democrat council leaders wrote to the Times complaining about the cuts. Is this a sign that your party is falling apart under the pressure of government and the fear of electoral eclipse?
No, it's not. Just a little technical point. Lord Oakeshott was only sort of unofficial spokesman.
But he's not even that anymore. he's now officially not the unofficial spokesman. He's got a more official status as a nobody
He's a completely free speech.
Right.
There's an issue about the banks. He thought we should have gone further, and we probably should go further. I think the bankers get ridiculous amounts of money, and I think that's what the party as a whole thinks. I think that's what the public thinks. Mm. But we've got some systems in place, and Labour left us with no systems in place. So it's getting better. There's a banking commission, and I hope they'll come up with even tougher rules in the future.
But I think a lot of people who voted for you are saying is that you've had to go, in joining the government, you've had to contradict a lot of your principles and policy aims.
Well, I understand why they might say it, because we ended up in a coalition with the Tories, which even I didn't really expect, which is truthful. Mm. But the reality is the public had the chance of a minority Tory government or a coalition. And I'm clear that faced with that bottling, it would have been no good. So we got stuck in and we've delivered loads. And we have to make sure people understand poor people out of tax, pensions linked with earnings, freedom bill tomorrow, getting rid of long periods of detention without trial, all sorts of horrible things.
The other side of that coin is that the trebling of university fees, VAT's risen, a lot of slashing of investment in public services that in your manifesto wouldn't have happened. There would have been a different balance of taxation to investment.
There would.
So I think for those people, surely people who support the government at the next election, they'll vote Tory. People who oppose the government, they'll vote Labour. Who's going to vote for you?
Lots of people at the last election didn't vote for us. Well, the answer is I'm working on these people supporting us, but it may take a while because we inherited, you know the figures, we inherited a position where we're paying 120 million quid a day to pay the interest on our debts. Not clever, not easy, we're taking difficult decisions. Now, they're difficult at the beginning. We hope if we get it right, it'll get easier. And yes, there is pain, but we're trying to make sure it's much fairer. And I'm clear, if it had been Tories on its own, it wouldn't have been nearly as fair.
Well, I mean, I think the question people ask is how can you demonstrate that? How do we know that's true? Because ultimately, you represent yourself to the public, I would say, as a party. People see politics in quite simple terms, I'd say. There are the parties that tax less and spend less, and the parties that tax more and spend more. And most people align themselves with one attitude or the other. And you represent yourself very much as a tax more, spend more on the left wing of politics. And now you seem to be supporting what is basically a right-wing government.
Well, Tories do come from the right, and we don't. The evidence of the things, we went to the election saying the most important thing for us was to have a fairer tax system, take poor people out of tax, delivered, happening in the budget this
April. But VAT is putting poor people into more tax.
Yeah, nobody wanted VAT, no party campaigned for it.
Well, the Tories did, didn't
they? Well, we thought...
Otherwise, what the hell are we doing? if even George Osborne isn't happy, then...
It's the least good option, but, you know, the other things were worse. We've made sure that rich people pay more on capital gains tax. We've made sure everybody here who's got a grandmother or grandfather, their pension will be tied to earnings. Labour never did it. Tories never did it. So I agree with you. We've got to be different. And we have delivered a fairer tax system than we would have had, a greener Britain, Green Deal, insulation on homes. And for things like education, where there have been some difficult decisions, we've delivered money for poor and disadvantaged youngsters starting at 2 and 3 and 4 and not later.
But ultimately, there's a massive cut in funding for higher education, and that's the absolute opposite of what your party said it's good for.
And our policy is we don't want tuition fees, we wouldn't like them, but the Tories and Labour were in favour of tuition fees. Bluntly, we were stuffed.
Right, so you... But well, fair enough. I completely agree with that analysis.
The reality is, you go into Parliament, you hold the balance of power, the other two parties are in favour of tuition fees, neither's going to agree with our policy. We still have a policy saying we want to get rid of them. It would have taken 6 years. That's still my view. It's still the party's view. But at the moment, that's not what we can deliver. We're in a coalition. You have to compromise.
But now, what Nick Clegg has been saying this week about higher education is he's encouraging the universities to widen the sort of social range of people who are going to university, which seems like a curious thing to do off the back of having made them more expensive. Well, they're sort of saying, now that you can charge £9,000, why don't you get some poorer people in?
Well, listen. The universities really don't deliver that sort of mixed background of people. If you go to poor rundown estates, if you go to people from poor income families, if you go to minority communities, children in care, very few of them in universities. Yesterday, there has been an announcement which means that every university that wants more than £6,000 as a fee will have to deliver something showing how many more of those people go to college. It's not perfect, but it's a much better
system. Is this not putting the entire onus on these poor universities? You cut their funding. And universities, they're not like banks. Yeah. People who run universities, basically nice people, underpaid people who like books and learning.
And
these aren't horrendous snobs in favour of the status quo.
That's why the most important work starts earlier. That's why I've been going around to schools and colleges and sixth forms saying, what do you actually want to make the choices between having an apprenticeship? We've given 70,000 more of those, or training, or college, or sixth form university. The answer is, they want to have that information when they're in year 9. They want to have clear choices. They want to know the costs. And above all, they want to know there won't be fees payable up front. You'll only pay if you can afford it.
Yes, but you're saying to the universities, look, you have to deliver this, the sort of social diversity that... But also you're offering, you're making them, if they're charging more money, I believe, offer a scholarship programme to more able, lower income students. Now, isn't that, the fact of that scholarship programme is an admission, isn't it, that these huge fees do put people off from poorer backgrounds? Even though you say you only pay them after university,
The reason I did not vote for the fee increase is because I was afraid that it would put people off. I understand that, yes. I represent the Old Kent Road. Lots of people who don't naturally go to university. I understand the school. Mm. And therefore, I thought when Parliament passed that, I needed to get stuck in and try and do something. And yes, scholarships is one deal, because the difference for a youngster thinking, can I go to university or not, of knowing they might get £3,000 a year to help with the costs, might be decisive. And if it goes to 16,000 extra youngsters who wouldn't otherwise go to university, that must be a bonus.
Well, I mean, that certainly is a bonus, but my fear is that you are in the middle and you may not get the credit for your intentions because it's not happening.
But I understand that, and we have to show you and these good people here the things that we deliver which wouldn't have happened if the Tories were there on their own. And I've said it's a fairer Britain in tax terms, it's poorer people out of tax, it's making sure richer people pay more as they should into the system, and it's make sure in the end we get the liberties back which Labour took away. Now, people will judge us, it will take five years, and I'll come back and
I'm afraid
be accountable to you later.
Well, absolutely, and I'll hold you to that, but thank you very much for coming on the show.
A
Simon
pleasure.
Hughes.
I'm Jimmy Carr. And tonight I'm launching Bankers in Need. This is my friend, Banksy. He's a pig. A big, fat, greedy pig. Say hello, Banksy. Now, a lot of people have been having a go at bankers just because their uncontrollable greed led to the collapse of our economy, meaning we've had to close schools, hospitals and police stations everywhere. But it's not easy for the banks. They've just been hit with an £800 million tax bill. Ouch. That hurts. Right, Banksy?
Not really. It barely affects us at all, actually.
Shh, Banksy. Don't forget, just a few £1,000 will keep a banker in clean, fresh drinking champagne for up to a whole lunch. But just how bad are things for the banks? We all remember Lloyd's famous black horse. We'll just take a look at him now. You all remember the enigmatic, sultry beauty from the Scottish Widows ads. Here she is today. Tragic. And what became of the happy-go-lucky Howard from the Halifax? Surely he's okay, right? Wrong. So sad. But what can we do to help these impoverished bankers? Well, we're already cutting their corporation tax from 28 to 24%. We're turning the UK into a giant tax haven by making sure banks don't have to pay tax on profits made overseas. But don't forget, we handed them a £500 billion bailout as well. But none of that's enough. We can all do more. Here's how. You can help bankers in need. 1. Bend over and shut up. 2. Elect a government that's almost entirely funded by the city. 3. Adapt to a lower standard of living. 4. Dig a little deeper. And a bit longer. More like an oblong. There you go. You've just dug your own grave. 5. Try and keep in mind when you read about RBS boss Stephen Hester's £2 million bonus that we're all in it together. Isn't that right, Banksy?
Nonsense. What are you talking about?
Remember, give a banker a fish and he'll say, a fish? I wanted all of your money. Give me all of your money. And the fish, I'll have the fish too. Let me give you something to think about. Every time a banker clicks his fingers, a wine waiter comes over to take his order. We want each and every one of you to buy a Bankers in Need piggy nose. You can pick them up at any library, Sure Start Centre or Citizens Advice Bureau. Well, you would be able to if we hadn't closed them all.
Sorry about that.
But buy one anyway, because remember, we're all paying through the nose. Please give whatever you can, and if you can't, don't worry, they'll get it anyway. Call now. Thanks, Banksy. Thank you.